look out at evangelicalism today and you look at the things that people in churches are saying about life, about Christian living, about what it means to walk with the Lord, about what it means to live in society, there's a great deal of confusion. Society itself is confused enough about issues of life and morality and godliness. But those who bear the name of Christ and call themselves Christians, if they are confused about who God is, and if they're confused about how we should live in light of what God has said, then there's a problem. So there is an urgency in this day for the church to hear the things that God has spoken. If God has spoken to us and the things that He has said are true, then those things must be heeded. There is an authority behind those words. It's important for us in this day and age to see that the things that God has said are true and to submit ourselves to that as the church. And we don't get to choose how we interact with those things or how those things interact with us. We don't get to choose how it crashes against who we are and what we feel and what we desire. Because if God has said it, and if God is true, then the things that He has said are true. And if the things that He has said are true, then there is a weight of authority underneath them that we must respond to.
And amen to that. Having seen that video clip, which is a short piece from an upcoming documentary called The God That Speaks, I want to open up this morning by asking you five questions. So bear with me, but here are my five questions for you as we begin today. Number one, do you believe that God spoke? Do you personally believe that God still speaks? Number two, when was the first time and the last or most recent time that God spoke to you? Number three, how often does God speak to you? Number four, what are the normal, if we can call it normal, or most frequently used ways that God speaks to you? And fifth and finally, and perhaps most importantly, what role do these questions and your answers play in your life? Does God speak to you, and how important is it that He does? How often does He speak to you? In what ways does He speak to you? And what role does His speaking play in your life? Well, with that established, I want to welcome you to the Bridge family. The Bridge family of Christ followers, on this, the first Sunday of 2018, Happy New Year, and welcome to our faith family. Welcome to a new year. Welcome to a new series that we've entitled Hold On, as we begin to walk word by word, verse by verse, through the book of Hebrews. You'll see as we go on later this morning and throughout the year that we've got a plan given by God. I can tell you He has spoken, and He's leading us to walk through this year the book of Hebrews, the book of Leviticus, and the book of Amos. Now, with the new year, let me tell you, I've also heard from the Lord, and this will be the year of reverence. If you've been with us, you know that last year we brought God glory by focusing on the process of making disciples who will make disciples who will make disciples. And I'm blessed to tell you that this year we'll continue to bring God glory and remain committed to making disciples who make disciples who make disciples. But this year our focus will be on revering the God of the Bible. We will focus on reverence. Now, let me ask you, do you know what this word reverence means? If you look in most traditional current dictionaries, you'll see words like honor and awe. But I went back to Webster's 1828 dictionary, and I love the definition there. Here we find that reverence is defined as fear mingled with respect and esteem. think about this. It's a healthy fear of Almighty God that is mingled with respect and esteem. Well, we're going to do our very best as a faith family this year to exemplify a reverence to and for Almighty God. And I pray that you're not only going to be blessed by that process, but that you're blessed even now thinking about that prospect, that you've got a passion to show a living reverence for Almighty God. You see, the big idea for today, as we press in to Hebrews, it embraces this reverence in part by starting off acknowledging how blessed we are. If you're a Christian, you have received the most amazing grace. You have received the most costly mercy. And I pray that you will see, again, the big idea from the first half of the first verse of Hebrews chapter 1, that you and I will see that God has gone to glorious, gracious, gospel lengths to ensure that you have an opportunity to love God and to listen to Him. You see, our message today is entitled, God Spoke. And I want you to think about that. What does that mean for your life? Not for the classroom, not for your answer on a church quiz, but for your everyday life. What does it mean for you that God spoke? I pray that you'll see it means a lot, and that it's packed with love that came at the highest cost. You see, we'll focus not only in this year-long series, but in this hour-long sermon on the Word of God and the God of the Word. Because the fact that He spoke is amongst the most important truths you will ever come to grips with. You'll see before we're done, it will define you. It will dictate your priorities, your sense of identity. In fact, let me just give you by way of preview where we're going. In terms of this year, we will be looking at the book of Hebrews, the series I have entitled Hold On, for reasons that will become clear shortly. But then we'll go to the book of Leviticus in a series that I've entitled Be Holy. And then we'll finish the year going to the book of Amos in a series I've entitled Hear Me. And you will see all three of those are focused on the blessing that is the truth that our God not only spoke, but He still speaks. Amen. Now, in terms of our time together today, in looking at verse 1 of Hebrews chapter 1, the first 11 words in the ESV translation, you and I will see that not only did God speak, but He spoke for specific purposes. You'll see first that God spoke that you and I would gain His perspective and His purposes. You'll see that God spoke so that you and I would have His promises and His purity. And before we're done, you'll see that God spoke so that you and I would have perseverance and passion for His purposes and His person. Now, with that said, I tell you that the miracle that defines us and the mission that deploys us, the miracle that saves us, and the mission that sanctifies us, they're both found exclusively in the message of our Messiah, Jesus the Christ. It's essential. If you have any hope, to have hope, you must hear the Word of God. You must hear and heed the Word of God and the God of the Word. It's the only place you and I will ever have any hope. Now, I love you enough to tell you that truth, and I pray that you'll love others enough to tell them that truth, and that ultimately our lives will live out this truth in such a way that there will be a sense of holiness and not hypocrisy that surrounds your witness. You'll see this is at the very heart of God's purposes. So let me first give you this text for our time together today, these first 11 words from Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. And I want you to listen very carefully. There's one assertive verb, and three modifiers, three adverbial phrases that all point to the same verb. Long ago, at many times, and in many ways, God spoke. God spoke. I ask you again, what role does the fact that God spoke and still speaks play in your life right now? If we turn that around, we see God spoke long ago. God spoke at many times. God spoke in many ways. Now, the primary way for you and I to build on this truth and the way to feed our souls and to be guided as we walk being Spirit-led is to acknowledge that God's primary way of speaking is through His Word. Through His Word, what we know as the Bible. And I want to show you yet another short clip to bring you into a calibrated place as a Christian, as the church, to understand our relationship to Christ, the Word that is God, through the Word of God. Watch this, and then we'll pick right back up.
What we believe about the Bible is based on what we believe about its source.
We have essentially a dual authorship. So it's true to say that Paul wrote Romans. It's equally true to say that God wrote Romans.
The Bible subjects itself to historical verification. It puts itself at risk of inquiry.
He says, we saw this. We didn't make up a story to make you feel better. We're not just giving you, you know, the spirit of Christmas or the inspiration of Easter. And that sets the Bible apart from almost everything else in the ancient world and its religious pantheon of gods and goddesses.
The textual richness of what is found in the New Testament is really very remarkable. It's utterly unique from documentation from the ancient world.
We don't go to the Bible wanting to judge the scriptures. We go to the Bible with a sense of submission, wanting to hear what the living God has to say to us, and that's crucial.
Nobody ever encounters God and says, that was boring and irrelevant. Well, when people say that about the Bible, it just says to me, they've not encountered the God of the Bible.
Let's be clear. If crucifixion was the end of Jesus' story, there is really no good historical explanation for why we have the Gospels or the rest of the New Testament at all. There had to be a reversal.
Do you think if Jesus really rose from the dead, that would have had an impact on the people that saw him after he had resurrected? Yeah, they would have remembered that till their grave.
The Church of Jesus Christ always faces a tremendous temptation, and that is to deviate from the Word of God.
In many quarters, the church has denied, questioned the faith.
Our faith is rooted in history, and consequently, we need to use the evidence and never be afraid of it.
So here again, let me just say to you, God spoke. If you and I lose sight of the fact that that's a truth that cannot be denied, we will be like so many others who have gone adrift, those who compromise this truth, those who marginalize or minimize the message of our Messiah. And nothing good comes from those who walk away from the fact that God spoke and He still speaks. I see it. No doubt you see it. Those that want to compromise with Christ, those that want to compromise with that which our King has said and laid out through His Word, it can't happen. Now, let me tell you that I'm not alone in this observation. I pray that you share it as well, but let me share with you a quote from J.I. Packer, who speaks to the problem of what happens when the people who claim God walk away from the proclamation that is of God. Here he says, and I quote J.I. Packer, "Certainty about the great issues of the Christian faith and conduct is lacking all along the line. The outside observer sees us, the church, as staggering on from gimmick to gimmick and from stunt to stunt, like a group of drunks in a fog, not knowing at all where we are or which way we should be going. Our preaching is hazy, our heads are muddled, our hearts fret, doubts drain our strength, and uncertainty paralyzes our actions. Unlike the first Christians who in three centuries won the Roman road, and the later Christians who pioneered the Reformation and Puritan Awakening, as well as the evangelical revivals and the great missionary movements of the last century, unlike them, we lack certainty. Why is this? Oh, we blame the external pressures of modern secularism, but that's like Eve blaming the serpent. This is a matter of the heart. This is a matter of the heart. The real truth is that we have grieved the Holy Spirit and we stand under divine judgment. For generations, our churches have suffered from a famine. Our churches have suffered from not hearing the word of God. End quote. Friends, long ago, at many times, and in many ways, God spoke. What role does that truth play in your life? What role should that truth play in yours and my life? Well, here I want to take you to our first point this morning to understand that God spoke to give you and me His perspective and His purposes. God spoke so that you and I would get Him, that we would get it. And He spoke so that your perspective would be His perspective. He spoke so that your purposes would be His purposes. Now, I believe that this is the underpinning message of the book of Hebrews. The entire book of Hebrews is here so that you and I would get God's perspective on all things. Now, I've entitled the sermon series, as you'll see, Hold On. That's because we need to hold on to the God who is the Word. We need to hold on to the Word of God. We need to hold on to our worship and love of Christ Jesus. We need to hold on to our want to glorify God. We need to hold on to our walk of spiritual integrity. We need to hold on to our work in kingdom service. We need to hold on ultimately to our witness for Christ that comes through a walk in Christ-likeness. We need to hold on and realize that this life, it's not about us. It's all about Christ. To gain His perspective and His purposes is to come to know the miracle that comes through the Messiah that puts us on mission. This is the message of Almighty God. This is what you'll find as we walk through the book of Hebrews, that it's all pointing to the fulfillment that is Christ. The point of our faith is to bring glory to God by embracing the gospel and the grace of Jesus the Christ. And this has been, from long ago, from the very beginning, the reason why God spoke. Let me show it to you in a way that now takes us away from the theologians and the academics to a very straightforward way of illustrating these truths, literally with the animation that a child would understand, that we would be the both and people of this truth and love about the message of our Messiah.
There's this crazy story at the beginning of the Bible. We have Adam and Eve, and they're in the Garden of Eden.
And everything in this garden is great. It's exactly as it should be, except there's this one tree that they're told by God not to eat from because it's dangerous and it will kill them.
So that's it. Avoid this fruit tree and we're fine.
Right. It seems pretty simple. But in this garden, there's a snake. And it starts telling a different story. It says that if you eat of this tree, it's not going to kill you. In fact, it's going to make you become like God.
And Adam and Eve, they believe the snake and they eat the fruit.
And because of this, the goodness of the garden is tragically lost and evil and death enters into God's good world.
Now, why is there a talking snake in the garden? I mean, This thing is a problem.
Yeah, it's very strange. And even more strange is the fact that the Bible doesn't say why or how this thing even got there. It just presents the snake as this creature who's in rebellion against God and that wants to get other people to doubt God's goodness and lead them on a path towards death. And so whatever this snake is, it's the source of evil that pervades our world and our lives, even still today.
But there is some hope, because right here in the story, God makes this really interesting promise to Adam and Eve.
That someone is going to come in the future, a son of Eve. And this guy's going to come and he's going to crush the serpent's head and destroy evil at its source. However, during this battle, the serpent is going to bite this guy's heel.
So it's like a mutual destruction.
Yeah, it's this very strange but beautiful promise. And it's just left hanging there until the next key moment in the story, when God singles out this guy named Abraham and says that through his family, goodness and blessing is going to be restored back to all of the nations of the world. And as we follow this family, we get to one of Abraham's great-grandsons, this guy named Judah. And he receives this promise that a king is going to come from his line and that the whole world's going to follow this king and he's going to bring peace and harmony and there'll be lots of food and wine and milk and vineyards and it's going to be awesome.
The first king that we meet from the line of Judah is a guy named King David. And he's a hero. Maybe he is the snake crusher.
But it turns out that David is infected with the same evil as the rest of humanity. He never crushes the snake, just the opposite. However, God makes a promise to David that this king is going to eventually come from his line. But as you go on in the story, one by one, each generation of his sons, they're just total chumps. They give in to the snake. They choose evil. They go after money and sex and power and following other gods.
Things get so bad that they run the nation of Israel right into the ground, and the big bad empire of Babylon just takes them out.
And so now there are no more kings to even fulfill this promise.
So it seems like the whole plan is lost.
But during these dark days, there's this crazy group of guys called prophets, and they just kept talking about this coming king and reminding us of the promise that he'll come, he'll defeat evil, he'll restore the garden. Now, one specific prophet, Isaiah, he tells us more about why this king is bitten. Isaiah says that the promised king receives this wound because of humanity's evil, and then it kills him. But then all of a sudden he comes back, and Isaiah says it's because he suffered this wound that he can now become a source of healing to other people.
But the Old Testament ends, and the snake-crushing king that everyone's been talking about never shows up.
And this is why, when the New Testament begins, it introduces us to Jesus of Nazareth, not as some random guy, but as someone who comes to fulfill these specific ancient promises.
Yeah, we learn that he's from the line of David, Judah, and Abraham.
And he goes around Israel announcing that the goodness of God's kingdom is here, now. And he begins confronting the effects of evil on people by healing them, by forgiving them of their sins and evil.
Many people are now believing that this is, in fact, the promised king.
But Jesus began telling his closest followers that he was going to become king and bring peace by taking the full effect of humanity's evil into himself.
The fatal snake bite wound.
Exactly. And so it seems like the serpent wins. And this story actually would be a tragedy except for what happens next. Jesus rises from the dead.
And now Jesus has the power over evil and death for himself.
And so the rest of the New Testament is then making this claim that Jesus's power over evil and death has now become available to us to begin confronting the effects of evil in our lives.
But even still, death and evil are a real problem in our world all around us.
And so the story of the Bible ends by describing this future day when Jesus comes back and he finishes the job. He destroys the snake once and for all, and he restores the goodness of the garden here on earth.
Now, from long ago, this is the message of our Messiah. Do you know this story? Do you recognize that God spoke long ago so that you and I would gain his perspective and understand his purposes? Now, think about it. If we go all the way back to the beginning of the Bible, you and I can hear God speak through the Word who is the Creator. John 1:1 tells us that Jesus is the Word and that he is there and is at the core of all of creation. You and I can hear God speak through the wow of the creation account. We could hear God speak through the warmth of the truth and the love that is shared in the Garden of Eden. You and I can hear God speak, if we're careful and we listen, in the midst of the warfare that comes between the fallen and the faithful, still in the Garden of Eden. You and I can hear God speak through the wrecking ball that is deceit and the discipline. Think of the great flood. You and I can hear God speak through the weaving together of a peculiar people, the family of God. We can hear God speak through the worshipers and their distinct worshiping guidelines given by God. We can hear God speak through the wondrous and miraculous displays of His glory. The heavens declare the glory of God. You and I can hear God speak through the workers, those spirit-empowered people of promise. Again, the family of God. Where again, we can hear God speak through what we know as the way, which is another way of describing the church, the family, the body of Christ. See, from long ago, God spoke so that you and I would gain His perspective and understand His purposes. Now again, our verse, our text for today, long ago, at many times, in many ways, God spoke. You see the historicity of God speaking long ago. You see the frequency of God speaking at many times. And you see the diversity with which God speaks in many ways. Well, let's look at that second point and come to recognize that God spoke at many times so that we, the people of God, would understand His promises and seek His purity. He spoke so that you, Christian, would come to understand His promises and then seek out His purity. I pray that you'll come to recognize that every single time that God has ever spoken, it has been in part to make sure that you would better understand His promises and that you would come to understand that He wants you to press in and seek His purity. Holiness matters. Justice matters. Righteousness matters. You're going to find that justice and righteousness are at the very core of Christian living. That at the core of the gospel, at the core of the grace, for the glory of God, justice and righteousness and the holiness of God matters. This is, again, the underpinning in the story of the book of Leviticus. That if you look at Leviticus chapter 1, verse 1, you're going to see that God spoke to Moses from outside the tent of meetings. When you go through the entire book of Leviticus and you come to the first verse of the book of Numbers, the very beginning of the next book, it says that then God spoke to Moses from inside the tent of meetings. What's that tell you? Tells you that the entire book of Leviticus is designed to help you and I understand the holiness of God and the holiness that is required to get near to God, that He wants you and me to understand the role of His holiness and the call for us to be Christ-like and to embrace and to seek out as best we can the holiness that is the witness that shows that we're not only walking with, but that we're truly worshiping Christ Jesus, our King. Watch this, and I pray it will either inform or inspire your understanding of holiness and why God spoke, so that you and I would get both the promises and the purity of our King.
You've probably heard the word holy before, or at least sang it in a church song once or twice. And for most people, this idea is really just connected to being a morally good person. So God is holy because He's morally perfect.
Yeah, that is part of it. But in the Bible, the idea of holiness is even bigger and more rich. What it's really describing is how God is the creative force behind the whole universe. He's the one and only being with the power to make a world full of such beauty and life. And so all these abilities, they make God utterly unique, which is the meaning of the word holy. So a helpful way to think about God's holiness is by using the sun as a metaphor. The sun is unique, at least within our solar system, and it's really powerful. It's the source of all this beautiful life on our planet. And so you could say that the sun is holy. And you can actually take this metaphor even further in that the whole area around the sun is also holy.
Yeah, because the closer you get to the sun, the more intense it gets.
Yeah, exactly. So that very power and goodness that generates all this life is also dangerous. I mean, the sun, if you get too close, will annihilate you. And in the same way, there's this paradox at the heart of God's own holiness, because if you're impure, his presence is dangerous to you. And not because it's bad, but because it's so good. And so the first time we see this paradox of God's holiness, it's in the story of Moses and the burning bush.
So God tells Moses to take off his sandals because he's standing on holy ground. And Moses covers his face in fear, and God says, hey, don't come any closer. It's intense.
It's actually that intensity of God's holiness that's explored even more in the stories about Israel's temple, which was the main place where God's holy presence was located. And at the center of the temple was this room called the Most Holy Place, the hot spot of God's presence. And whether you're an Israelite living in the land around the temple or a priest working right in the temple, you're in proximity to God's holy presence, which is dangerous.
Yeah, this is a problem. So how's it supposed to work?
Well, in the Bible, the solution is that you need to become pure.
So like being morally pure.
Yeah, and that's easy enough to understand. But the Bible spends a lot of time talking about another kind of purity, being ritually pure, which is a state where you separate yourself from anything related to death, like touching things like diseased skin or dead bodies or even certain bodily fluids. All these make you impure. And becoming ritually impure isn't necessarily sinful. What's wrong is waltzing into God's presence when you're in an impure state. And so that's why God gave the Israelites very clear instructions for knowing when they were impure, steps to become pure, so that they could go into the temple again.
So that's what the book of Leviticus is about.
Right. But it doesn't stop there. This idea keeps developing. So later in the scriptures, we find this really interesting story by a prophet named Isaiah. And he has this crazy vision where he's in the temple and he's right in God's presence. He's totally terrified.
Yeah, he knows the rules. He shouldn't even be in there. And he's worried about being destroyed.
And then this crazy creature called a seraphim.
Yeah, that is a crazy creature.
Totally. So it flies over with a hot coal, and then it sears Isaiah's lips with the coal and says something really weird. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for.
So this burning coal somehow makes Isaiah pure.
Yeah, it's remarkable because normally if you touch something impure, it transfers its impurity to you. But now here's this new idea where you have this coal, this very holy and pure object, and it touches Isaiah and it transfers its purity to him. Isaiah is not destroyed by God's holiness. He's transformed by it. I mean, the implications of this are just huge. But there's one more development. This time from another prophet, Ezekiel. And he has this vision where he's standing at the temple and he sees water trickling out from it. And then that water turns into a stream and then it grows into a deep river that starts flowing through the desert, leaving this trail of green trees behind it. And then it flows into the Dead Sea, making everything fresh and alive.
So instead of becoming pure first and then going into the temple, here God's holiness comes out from the temple, making things pure and bringing them to life. What does it all mean?
So we don't know until we meet this man, Jesus. And he claims that he's fulfilling all of these ancient visions, but in surprising new ways. So Jesus, he went around touching people who are impure, people with skin diseases, a woman with chronic bleeding, or dead people. And when he touches them, their impurity should transfer over to Jesus. But instead, Jesus's purity transfers to them and actually heals their bodies.
Jesus is like that holy coal in Isaiah's vision.
Right. And Jesus claimed that he was the human embodiment of God's own holiness and that he and his followers were now God's temple, so that through them, God's holy presence would go out into the world and bring life and healing and hope. And so this is why Jesus described his followers as having streams of living water flowing out of them.
So this is our part of the story where we find ourselves now, but Where's this all heading?
So the last pages of the Bible end with a final vision about God's holiness. This time it's by a guy named John. And in his vision, we see the whole world made completely new. The entire earth has become God's temple. And Ezekiel's river is there, flowing out of God's presence, immersing all of creation, removing all impurity, and bringing everything back to life.
Now, let me ask you again, how important is it that you understand that God spoke and that God is still speaking through his word? I want you to think about it this way. God spoke so that you and I would get his perspective and his purposes. God also spoke so that you and I, as we see here many times, he spoke so that you and I would understand his promises and press in to his purity. Again, go back through the Bible. Go back through history. You see the tension between the promises and the purity right there in the Garden of Eden, in what we know as the fall. You see it with the great flood. You see it at the Tower of Babel. You'll see it when you look at the lives of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You see it with Joseph and his brothers. You see it with Moses and Aaron and the Israelites, with the Egyptians, with the Exodus, with the evil that was within the people that had just come out of Egypt through the Exodus. This constant tension between the promises and the purity. This is why God spoke. Think about it. Look at David and the divided kingdom. Look at it when you see the godless perversions throughout the Bible in contrast to the godly prophets and the proclaimers. You see it throughout with the dispersions and the deliverance, both of which speak the divine message of Almighty God. So again, now let's look at the third piece. God spoke long ago. God spoke at many times, and God spoke in many ways. Here we see that God spoke in many ways so that you and I would gain perseverance and passion. He spoke so that you and I would know those promises and that we would be the people who would persevere in the midst of his purposes, and that we would have a passion for the person of Christ and the purity that he's called us to. Now, when you think about the ways in which God speaks and that diversity, Richard Blackaby will tell you, and I agree, that the primary way in which God speaks today is through the Word of God. That's why we began there with the Bible. Secondarily, he speaks through our prayers. Third, he'll speak through other believers. And at times, fourth, he'll speak through providential circumstances. Now, it's important to understand that the Word of God, the prayers from God that are answered, the people of God speaking in, and then the providential circumstances under God's control, in that order. Because typically today, we see people in the church turn that upside down. They see some circumstance that makes them feel the way they want to feel or points to something that they want. Oh, I saw two birds flying east. That's how I know that God wants me to marry that person or to begin to do this relationship that's over in the east. And then we go and we ask some other Christian, hey, do you think God wants me to be happy over in the east? Oh, absolutely. And then we go and we pray about it and we say, I believe, I absolutely believe it was not a late night pizza. I think God told me that he definitely wanted me to do X, Y, or Z. And then we go look for a verse in the Bible that will somehow validate what we want and what we've manufactured. Friends, it's important to understand that the way God speaks, first and foremost through his word, secondarily, personally and directly through answered prayer, thirdly, will be oftentimes through an unsolicited, truly gifted message from God through another believer. And fourthly, and it happens, through providential circumstances. But as true as that is, and as valuable as Blackaby's observations are, I want to offer you five categories in which God tends to speak. You see, I believe that if you look through all of human history, if you walk through the Bible or your life personally, what you'll find is that God tends to speak in these five categories of life. You'll hear him speak through a miracle. Now, if you're a Christian, you know what I mean because you've received the miracle of his repentance, his faith, his grace that saves. But I think he also speaks through the category of maintenance, that there are things in our lives, day in and day out, where God is speaking to us through the ins and outs of everyday living. Remember, all good things come from above. Anything that is sustaining you is a gift. It is an expression of God touching and talking to you. Thirdly, I believe God speaks through the category of promises. We've said it earlier that if you have any hope at all, it's because you've heard some of the promises of God. So he speaks through miracles, he speaks through the maintenance, he speaks through the promises. Fourth, he speaks through warnings. And here again, I say to you, go to your Bible. You'll find that the miracles, the maintenance, the promises, and the warnings, they're all throughout Scripture. And if you're honest and you look back at your life, you'll find that they're all throughout your life as well. That God has spoken when you're teetering on the precipice of sin, when you're contemplating disobedience, God will send you that sweet, gracious tap on the shoulder, that warning that may have come through a sermon or a pastor or a loved one or a friend, or maybe an inadvertent thought to be stranger that God sent specifically to send you a warning. The last one is through discipline. And here again, you'll find throughout the Bible, God speaks loudly and lovingly through discipline. I can tell you personally, one of the sweetest times in my life was one of the hardest. God spoke to me loudest while he was breaking me, pulverizing me down to fine dust. I was broken down to the point of powdered dust. And while I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy, I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world, because I heard God speak. And I know now that he speaks. And I say to you, he spoke long ago, he spoke at many times, and he spoke and still speaks in many ways. I want you to think about it this way. Every single time that God has spoken or does speak today, it's to encourage our perseverance in his purity and to help us to gain a passion for his purposes. Every time God speaks, in the diversity of his speaking, it is to help you and me to gain perseverance in our pursuit of his purity and to gain a passion for his purposes, which, by the way, are his people. This is what you'll find. You see, God has always been passionate to speak to us for these reasons. Justice, holiness, righteousness. These are at the very heart of God. And he wants you and me to hear him speaking and equipping us to pursue his justice, to pursue his righteousness, to pursue his holiness. And let me just say, there are people out there, and hear me, that are telling you and will continue to tell you that God's grace is so big that his holiness doesn't matter anymore. That grace is so big that justice doesn't matter anymore. That his grace is so big that righteousness doesn't matter anymore. Hear me, friends. Those are liars and lunatics. They are heretics that are perverting the word of God. His grace, expressed through his speaking, is not so that you and I will somehow get a license to live out these liberties that walk away from the love of God. No. He's given us his grace so that we would hear him when he speaks, that we would be empowered by his Spirit so that we would know his perspective and his purposes, his promises and his call for purity. And right here, that we would be able to persevere in our pursuit of his purity, and that we would gain a passion, not for living in sin and calling that grace's reward, no, but to live out a life of sanctification, that we would bring glory to our God by championing his grace, by sharing his gospel, by being the people that he spoke life into, that we would be the people of his justice, his righteousness, his love, his mercy, his holiness. Watch this, and again, I pray, be blessed as God speaks to you through the applied truths of his word.
If you were a praying mantis, it would be socially acceptable to devour your mate.
And if you're a honey badger, you have no regard for other animals. You don't care.
If you're a panda with twins, it's normal to abandon one to take care of the other.
But if humans do any of these things, we would call it wrong, unfair, or unjust.
Yeah, why is that? Why do humans care so much about justice?
Well, the Bible has a fascinating response to that question. On page one, humans are set apart from all other creatures as the image of God.
Yeah, God's representatives who rule the world by his definition of good and evil.
And this identity, it's the bedrock of the Bible's view of justice. All humans are equal before God and have the right to be treated with dignity and fairness no matter who you are.
And that would be nice if we all did that. But we know how the world really works.
And the Bible addresses that too. It shows how we are constantly redefining good and evil to our own advantage at the expense of others.
Yeah, self-preservation. And the weaker someone is, the easier it is to take advantage of them.
And so in the biblical story, we see this happening on a personal level, but also in families, and then in communities, and in whole civilizations that create injustice, especially towards the vulnerable. But the story doesn't end there. Out of this whole mess, God chose a man named Abraham to start a new kind of family. Specifically, Abraham was to teach his family to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice.
Yeah, doing righteousness, that's a Bible word I don't really use, but what comes to mind is being a good person.
But what does that even mean, being good? The biblical Hebrew word for righteousness is tzedakah, and it's more specific. It's an ethical standard that refers to right relationships between people. It's about treating others as the image of God.
With the God-given dignity they deserve.
And this word justice, it's the Hebrew word mishpat. It can refer to retributive justice.
Like if I steal something, I pay the consequences.
Exactly. Yet most often in the Bible, mishpat refers to restorative justice. It means going a step further, actually seeking out vulnerable people who are being taken advantage of and helping them.
Yeah, some people call this charity.
But mishpat involves way more. It means taking steps to advocate for the vulnerable and changing social structures to prevent injustice.
So justice and righteousness are about a radical, selfless way of life.
Yeah, and you find this idea all over the Bible. Like here, in the book of Proverbs, what does it mean to bring about just righteousness?
Open your mouth for those who can't speak for themselves.
And what do these words mean for the prophets, like Jeremiah?
Rescue the disadvantaged, and don't tolerate oppression or violence against the immigrant, the orphan, and the widow.
And like here, look in the book of Psalms.
The Lord God upholds justice for the oppressed, gives food to the hungry, and sets the prisoner free. But he thwarts the way of the wicked. Whoa, he thwarts the wicked?
Yeah, in Hebrew, the word wicked is rasha. It means guilty or in the wrong. It refers to someone who mistreats another human, ignoring their dignity as an image of God.
So justice and righteousness is a big deal to God.
Yes, it's what Abraham's family, the Israelites, were to be all about. They ended up as immigrant slaves, being oppressed unjustly in Egypt. And so God confronted Egypt's evil, declaring them to be rasha, guilty of injustice. And so he rescued Israel. But the tragic irony of the Old Testament story is that these redeemed people went on to commit the same acts of injustice against the vulnerable. And so God sent prophets who declared Israel guilty.
But they weren't the only ones. There's injustice everywhere.
Yeah, some people actively perpetrate injustice. Others receive benefits or privileges from unjust social structures they take for granted. And sadly, history has shown that when the oppressed gain power, they often become oppressors themselves.
So we all participate in injustice, actively or passively, even unintentionally. We're all the guilty ones.
And so this is the surprising message of the biblical story. God's response to humanity's legacy of injustice is to give us a gift, the life of Jesus. He did righteousness and justice, and yet he died on behalf of the guilty. But then God declared Jesus to be the righteous one when he rose from the dead. And so now Jesus offers his life to the guilty so that they too can be declared righteous before God, not because of anything they've done, but because of what Jesus did for them.
The earliest followers of Jesus experienced this righteousness from God, not just as a new status, but as a power that changed their lives and compelled them to act in surprising new ways.
Yeah, if God declared someone righteous when they didn't deserve it, the only reasonable response is to go and seek righteousness and justice for others.
This is a radical way of life, and it's not always convenient or easy. It's courageously making other people's problems my problems.
This is what Jesus meant by loving your neighbor as yourself. It's about a lifetime commitment fueled by the words of the ancient prophet Micah. God has told you, humans, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. It's to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Here again I say to you, amen. God spoke long ago at many times and in many ways. Here you see that one of the reasons God spoke in many ways is to encourage our perseverance in his purity and to help us to develop his passion for his purposes. Lord, I pray that, Lord, speak to us. Speak to your people. Bring this truth home. You see, I think this is again a parallel, this time to the book of Amos. I think Amos is given to us in part that we would hear God speak, that we are called to persevere in his purity, to not drift away into the ways of the world, and that we would develop a passion for his purposes and his people. Think about this here again, the very opening words of the book of Amos. First chapter, verse 2. And Amos said, "The Lord roars from Zion, and his voice utters from Jerusalem." The Lord roars. Do you think that he's not passionate about justice and righteousness and holiness? Oh, if you think so, you don't know the God of the Bible. You see, our God has spoken so that you and I will persevere in purity, that you and I will gain his perspective, share his purposes, celebrate his promises, pursue his purity, persevere along the way, and develop a passion for his people and his purposes. Oh, friend, I pray as we come to a close, we look back on this short text long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke. Think about it. Jesus is called the Word. How important is communication to a God who identifies himself as the Word? I ask you again where we began. What role does God's speaking play in your life? I pray to God you realize it needs to play a huge part. It needs to come from your heart. It's the only place where hope will come from. And if you're not hearing from him, cry out to Jesus. You see, friends, the real question is not, does God speak? The real question is, will we listen? I ask you, will you believe and obey? Will you press in? I think of John 3:36. It says it all. It brings this understanding right to the forefront. It brings you and me to the fork in the eternal road. We're told whoever believes, and there's grace, whoever believes biblically in the Son has eternal life. But whoever does not obey does not have life, but the wrath of God remains on them. You see, here's that great tension of God's grace and God's glory on display. And he will not compromise. He has spoken that you would hear and respond. Now, for some, no doubt, that doesn't sound nice. It doesn't sit well. Many in church who are not comfortable in Christ would say, "I don't know that I like that, Pastor Jeff." Well, I can tell you why you don't. It's in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, where again God spoke and said, "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow. And this word of God, it is discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." I want to ask you, churchgoer, Are you coming to Christ? Are you hearing and responding to the Word of God? Gathering is not the same as following. Gathering is static. Following is faithful. Before we close in prayer, I want to leave you with one more video. And this time it's a song, and I want you to listen carefully to the words. I'm blessed to tell you that the song has come from my daughter. And her words are passionate and powerful, and they portray the truth that God has spoken, and we must respond. Listen to this song, I pray, and hear God.
Okay, this is my uncomfortable question.
God spoke so that you would know that he is king. And let me just tell you, friends, you don't manage, balance, or juggle a king. He is our one and only Lord and Savior. God spoke so that you and I would gain his perspective and his purpose. share in his promises and his purity, and that we'd be blessed with his perseverance and passion. That's why he spoke. And I ask you, how important is it to you that he is still speaking? What role does the Word of God and the God of the Word play in your life? I point you to 2 Timothy 3:16-17, the place that I normally begin in a discussion like today, so that you'll be reminded that not only did he speak, but every word of God in the Bible is breathed out by God, and it's here for the purpose of refining the way you and I think and live. That's why he spoke. And before I pray, I want to leave you with the words from God to his people through Paul to Titus, and now me to you, a life verse for me that I pray will stay with you as you understand the God who spoke has called you to speak on his behalf. Titus 2:15, declare these things. Declare these things. Exhort, that means call people out. And rebuke. I'm sorry, that's the calling out. The exhorting is the encouraging. The both and of encourage and if need be call out. With all authority. Which authority? Christ's authority that he gave to us. Remember, all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. Therefore, you go with my authority and you make disciples of all nations. And don't sweat it. I'll be with you always, even to the end of the age. Titus 2:15 closes by saying, and let no one disregard you. That doesn't mean get loud. It means shine bright and warm. Be the aroma of Christ that cannot be denied. Be the witness that is holding on to the truth that God spoke, he saves, and he sanctifies his people. Amen. Would you pray with me? Oh, Lord, thank you so much that we have you and your word. I pray that all year long and for the rest of our lives, we will be concentrated on the Word of God and focused on and submitted to you, the God of the Word. Lord, let us settle for nothing else. Let us call out compromise and hypocrisy. Let us be the inspirations that you died to give life to. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen.